Firstly, thank you for coming. It is about JavaScript. I just couched it in words that people might be more comfortable with, but it is going to be about JavaScript. What we're going to do is we're going to cover the history of JavaScript right from the beginning and show you just how much it's changed and how much it's evolved over that time, because it's been a fascinating journey where it started off as and where it is now. But just a bit of background. In June of this year, I wrote 4 articles for Crate.js about how JavaScript got fast, because it shouldn't be. As a language, it's got a lot of nice properties about it, but it shouldn't be fast. And it's been made to be fast, so that's quite technical stuff, but if you're really into the nuts and bolts of it, like the proper neck beard, how it got fast, go there. But this is more a kind of historical thing. So I'm going to start with what JavaScript is first. We're going to lay the groundwork just with something fundamental, and we'll build on that as to where it is now. There's going to be some history bits, and they're the fun bits, kind of looking back at where it's come from and what the web looked like before JavaScript, which is quite amusing. And there's some science bits, so it's going to have to be some techie stuff. So, but I'll try and couch some techie stuff in ways that it's going to be clear. And they'll be quite quick. They're like speed bumps, we'll be right through them pretty much. And lots of examples. So I'm trying to do some visual stuff to kind of communicate all of these innovations along the way. So with each of the examples, what I've also tried to do is give you a little bit of a recipe. So I'll show you the example. I'll also give you a URL, so when the slides go up, you can just hit the URLs and go to those examples and see them yourself. But I've also tried to sort of give you an idea of what's going on under the hood. Because the thing with JavaScript is it glues other technologies together. So this is an example of, say, Gmail would probably be this. So you need a browser. Browser has a JavaScript engine inside it. So if you take one thing away from the talk, JavaScript is glue. It glues stuff together. Okay. So what is it? I think most of you here have got some sort of webby background, but I'm going to start with absolute basics. This is a modern web page has 3 technologies built into the browser. It has HTML, which has been around forever. It has CSS and JavaScript. So HTML is the content of your page. If you use something like WordPress and you put in your body copy and your title, something like that, that ends up in your HTML. So when you type in your database, it ends up in the HTML. If you view the source, you'll see all of your, everything you typed in will be in the HTML. CSS is how that HTML looks. So that says this link is green, this thing goes over here, all of that sort of stuff. JavaScript is what it does. Okay, so content is in your HTML. CSS is how it looks. JavaScript is what it does. So JavaScript is about doing things. It's all about verbs and actions and that kind of thing. That's what we think of. So I'm going to hammer this home with a demo. So we're going to take Twitter apart, and we're going to have a look at what Twitter looks like when you switch off CSS and you switch off JavaScript. Because Twitter is a modern web app. And sorry, let's move over here. If we go to Twitter. So everyone knows what Twitter looks like. Twitter does a couple of interesting things. If you scroll to the bottom, that little thing you saw spinning there is JavaScript. It's running off to the web server, getting more content and gluing it on the bottom of the page. So if we switch off, well, let's do CSS for it because it's the funniest. If we switch off CSS, it looks like hell. That's what raw HTML looks like. So the early web looked like that. There was no CSS, there was no JavaScript. And if you go and go the whole hog and switch JavaScript up as well, for some reason it needs a refresh to work. But what will happen is you get to the end of the page and that doesn't, it'll sit there, because that's a little GIF running round and round there. It's not actually doing anything. And it's because JavaScript is no longer working. So it's all about actions. And it can't do any actions because there's no JavaScript there. It's not doing any actions. And what you'll find is if you go to things like Trello or any modern web app, it just won't even try. giving up. They all give up. Same with something like, let's try, Gmail's not going to do it. So maybe Google Docs, yeah. If you think about it, anything that's got actions to it, like you're trying to create a document, that will not fly without JavaScript. So HTML is about documents, but JavaScript is about actions and making things work. Hammer that home, set that back on, and CSS is back on. Okay. Cool, right. So, right. Why do people use JavaScript? A bunch of reasons. Firstly, it's really useful. It does simple things, like you can get some user input from it. You can get the keyboard, you can get the mouse, you can get touch events. All of those things JavaScript can know about. So that's good. You can also output stuff. So you can throw stuff to the monitor, to the speakers. You can use web audio and get things to the speakers. So that's already useful. You can get stuff in the user. JavaScript goes clever things inside and it can shoot stuff out to the monitor. And that would use that. We would use HTML to do that or CSS. It speaks these languages natively as well. The other two languages that are in your browser, HTML and CSS, JavaScript can write those languages. But you can't go the other way. HTML cannot write JavaScript. CSS knows nothing about JavaScript. If you can go the other way, JavaScript can write CSS. It can add, it can take the CSS that's there, change it, put it back, can write new stuff, put it back. So that's what makes it really versatile. It sits in the middle and it can change all of the things around it, everything else in the environment. So. And also, of course, it talks to web servers and APIs and those sort of things. So that in itself is great. That's a reason to use it, because that's incredibly handy. In fact, you can build a lot of web apps just with that alone. And the other thing is, of course, it's everywhere because it's in your browser. And the browser's everywhere because the web is really popular, as it turns out. So lots of tablets, lots of smartphones, millions of computers. And in other places too, so I'll get to that later on. But it's, you know, it's everywhere. So that's, you know, as a language, that's a great platform to work on because it works everywhere. So it's popular. This is such a nerdy graph. I'll explain what's going on here. So this is Stack Overflow questions versus projects on GitHub. Like, this is probably the nerdiest thing in the whole talk. But the point of projects on GitHub. For anybody who's not a techie, you keep your source code safe by saving it on a company like GitHub. This thing called source control. So you save all your code there, and it turns out the most popular language on GitHub is JavaScript. And also, Stack Overflow is kind of the dirty little secret of programmers. If you want a question answered, you go to Stack Overflow, and somebody has asked that question, and you would get a raft of answers on the back of that. And it turns out, of course, JavaScript is the most popular of the languages on that. So with that kind of slightly odd graph, JavaScript is very, very popular as well. So. And it's been around a while. It's 18 years now. You know, this is Brendan Eich who invented the language back in 1995. And he gave a talk this year kind of going over what has happened over that period of time. So what I thought I'd do is we'll look back at 1995. Does anybody here remember 1995? I see people grey hair as well, so yeah, thank you. Yes, I don't feel alone. Just to kind of jog your memory, right, this is a bit context here. We're in the middle of Britpop, if you remember that, so Blur vs Oasis. Your James Bond would be Pierce Brosnan. Wee Babies are massive for some reason. And Windows 95 just came out in PlayStation. So there you go, 1995. But the web is a very different place at this point. There's no social media. There's none. I mean, there's no Twitter, no Facebook. And in fact, most surprising of all for me, is that there was no Google. Amazon looks like this. Amazon just launched. Isn't it beautiful? It's got a thing. This gray is something you will, if you remember the early days of the web, that gray will haunt you forever.
Times New Roman.
Yeah, Times New Roman. The thing with this, of course, there's no CSS, there's no styling. You could do a certain amount of styling in HTML, but it wasn't. HTML is about documents. It's about communicating a document with a bunch of images and links and whatever. CSS came later. And in fact, it came after JavaScript. So back in 1995, this was the only technology there was. It was HTML. If you're looking to do stuff on the web, plugins weren't around. Flash, none of that stuff was around. And these were the two giants of the time. We had Internet Explorer. This is Microsoft's website from then. Internet Explorer launched with Windows 95, so they had realized that the web was going to be something, and they put a browser in Windows 95, which gave them huge reach straight away. Netscape were already off and running. They came from the original NCSA team who built the first browsers. But this was a commercial entity as well, and they were about to float as well this year. This was the first big dot-com float. And they had an idea. Let's go back here, actually. They competed on features in the browser. So Netscape versus IE, whichever side you were on, they put features in the browser, and if it was popular, it would be copied by the other one. So what would happen is you get this kind of arms race going on as if somebody had the blink tag, we got the blink tag, right? And that stuff went on and all the time. So Netscape had this in the bag. Just before they were about to float, they thought, wouldn't it be useful to have a programming language in the browser, in addition to the document stuff, which is HTML? And this was the vision. So this is where I'm getting this glue thing from. We aim to provide a glue language for the web designers and part-time programmers. That would be us, by the way. This one's hilarious. We saw Java as the component language used by higher-priced programmers, right? So people in white coats and suits and stuff writing proper language. Now that was, at the time, I mean, that was kind of a fair way to go. So Java was very hot at that point. So what they did was they hired this guy. This is Brendan Eich. And he had worked at a company called Silicon Graphics, if anyone remembers those. They made big purple graphics workstations, and they were very cool. I remember really wanting these things. So he'd written operating system code and network code and stuff for that company, and he was really smart. So they hired him in April of 1995, and he was going to write this language, this glue language in Netscape. And it's called Mocha. And then it was called LiveScript, and then it was called JavaScript. And it had a bunch of names. As the marketing department took over, it was called JavaScript because Java was the hot thing at the time. So it has nothing to do with Java, really. And he wrote it in 10 days, and I cannot get my head around this. This is nuts. I mean, this language is the most popular programming language in the world, and it was written in 10 days. And not only did he design the language in 10 days, he also wrote the compiler. Now, the compiler is what takes your JavaScript, the code that you've written, and turns it into instructions that your computer can understand. He prototyped the compiler in that time. And then if you ever think, like, I've got a lot of work on, you know, nothing. 10 days, insane. What a rock star. So as he said himself, it could have been worse, you know. It could have been a lot worse. So I'm not going to go into what these things are, but basically red stuff, bad stuff, we don't like that. That was green, it's turned black in this, obviously. But anything in the black one is kind of good stuff. So, you know, in 10 days, that was not a bad effort, actually. The most important feature he built into the language was that he allowed it to be changed. It's a very pliable language. You can make JavaScript do stuff that are, yeah, sort of evil things. I mean, you can make it do good things and bad things, but it's entirely up to you. But everything is an object. There's a whole bunch of kind of nice things that allow you to go in there and tinker with the language to make it right. And the reason that was done is because it was done in 10 days. He rushed it. You know, it really was pushed through quite quick. So what's interesting is that has been incredibly useful to it down the line, because this thing has become other things along the way. And we'll get into that later on. But that's why it is as pliable as it is. Right, so we've got this language. Let's make it useful. So I love this quote. This is actually applies to the IBM PC, but personally I think this applies to what JavaScript was like when it launched. It's slow and it's hard to use. So, JavaScript launched between 95 and 2000. The term DHTML came around, and the idea was this is HTML, but it's dynamic. We can do things with JavaScript to change the HTML. So DHTML was the hotness. Everybody, you know, if you're a web developer, you write that on your CV, you got a job. What it did, in my opinion, is form validation. It did three. I've got three examples here, but this is a kind of giving an example of what this thing did. Form validation is the most useful thing it did. So if you imagine Amazon set up the year before, the way, if you wanted to buy a book on Amazon, how that would work is you would put in your credit card details once you decided in your book, and it would send all of those over the internet to a web server. Then they would be processed on the web server, and if anything was wrong, they would send you another page back with all the details saying this isn't right. What would happen is you ping pong until the thing was right. And if you lost a connection at some point, you know, people are on dial-ups and stuff. You don't know if your credit cards have been spent. You don't know. You don't. It's an absolutely hellish user experience. So foreign validation was its initial use case. So what that would do is if you put in, say, your credit card details and it was going to be your card had run out, it can check that and it can tell you before it sends the page up. So that's a good thing. That's a very useful advance. However, it also did things like this. Does anyone remember JavaScript rollovers? Right. I coded one of these the other day. I'm going to show you it anyway. I coded one just out of curiosity to see what it was like. So if you had one of these on your web page, you were the business. Right. Here's a picture. You roll over it. Oh my God, it changes. Oh my God, oh my God. And I did this just for fun. That was the extent of what JavaScript. This was everywhere. People were doing this stuff. It was bizarre. And the other one, 1, 2, 3, is pop-ups. If you remember pop-ups, these have now been blocked, but they were just the most hellish things in the world. But it turns out, years down the line, right? DHTML is now ironic. There is a conference next year where you can go and meet the original Dreamweaver team. Is this a joke? Yes, it's a joke, but it's an event you can actually attend. I love this. I still want to be there. But anyway, get back to where we are. But that's what the web looked like with DHTML. And we don't miss it. Okay. Right, the next innovation came about 5 years later. This is XHR, or XML HTTP request, the proper Sunday name. And it came, of all places, in Outlook. It came from Microsoft. So they generally don't get a lot of love when it comes to the web, mainly for IE6, but for other reasons. But what they did was they wanted to have a mail client on the web, like Outlook. And in order to do it, they hit the same problem that everybody hits, is that you need a new page every time. If you wanted to get your email and then refresh, if new email came in, you have to refresh the browser every single time. What XHR does is, in the background, it makes a request to the server. It says, have we got new email? If the answer is yes, it pulls the data back down and then doesn't refresh the page. It uses that data with JavaScript and just rewrites the page. That's incredibly useful. And nobody used it. Nobody saw it. It's completely ignored. It was actually Google, well, there's a couple of other companies too, but Google popularized it with Gmail 4 years later. The thing is, that's still a mail client, just because Google are doing it, all of a sudden it's taken off. And they really hit it big time with Google Maps, because Google Maps is a beautiful use case for this, because what it's doing is, you have your map, if you want to scroll to the left, it says, I have moved here, it makes that request to the server, you get a bunch of new map tiles, they come back down, and it redraws the page, and all of that is happening without refreshing the browser. So that's good, that's cool, that's a really good thing. So this became known, this whole technique, if you bundle it all together, became known as AJAX. This chap coined the phrase. So AJAX was asynchronous JavaScript and XML. Right. So it had a name. So everyone was like switching DHTML off their CVs and writing AJAX on, right? It's the same thing, basically. Right, we're going to do some techie stuff. So I'm calling it things inside things. But what I want to explain is the difference between a web browser, a JavaScript engine, and a JavaScript compiler, because we're going to use that information later on. So, you've all seen that. That's a web browser. We all comfy? Yeah, good. If you look in, it's barely a car. If you look inside, there's a bunch of moving parts, okay? We're not interested in most of that. We're going to look at one part, which is the JavaScript engine. So, the browser is doing lots of stuff. It's talking to data and the user interface and whatnot. But the JavaScript engine, its job is to take the JavaScript code, interpret it, and make it run on your machine. Its sole purpose is to turn that JavaScript code into something the machine can understand. if you go inside the JavaScript engine, it has a bunch of little bits and bobs going on. I won't go into what those are, but effectively, you can think of them as compilers. It's not quite like that, but there's compilers are parts of the JavaScript engine. Okay, they're doing clever things inside to make the JavaScript engine work fast and well. Okay, so compilers live inside the engine. The engine lives inside the browser. Matryoshka dolls. Think of it that way. Dun-dun-dun. Okay, that was easy. Yeah, could be worse. I'm going to explain the FastLim correctly because it's not obvious. FastLim correct is things you would like your code to be. Right? These are good things. You'd like it to be fast, you'd like it to be slim, you'd like it to be correct. So I'll explain what I mean by that. Fast code, you can obviously accomplish more things in less time. You can also tackle larger problems because you can have it done quicker. So if your code runs fast, that's good. Fast is good. We want code to run fast. Slim is also good. Because if you think about it, you're pulling down code over a dial-up modem or your phone. You're paying for that, you know, and it's 300K file is better than a 2 gig file. Yeah. So slim code is good. We like tight slim code. So fast, slim, and correct. You know, it's nice if it does what you asked it to do, right? Which is where this quote comes from. Again, this is Brendan. Fast, slim, correct, right? Any two, but it has to work, right? If it doesn't work, it doesn't matter how fast it is, if it blows up, that's bad, right? So these are desirable things. Unfortunately, back in 98, when these engines were just getting going, we really only had two JavaScript engines, the JScript and Microsoft's one, and SpiderMonkey inside what was Netscape back then. They weren't fast, they weren't slim, they weren't correct. The reason they're not correct is because you had two competing companies implementing the same thing in different ways. So that's bad, you know, that's not good. So I'm just going to explain how we got all of these boxes ticked. So web standards was a big one. The actual JavaScript standard got standardized by these guys at the top, and the web standards project was a kind of grassroots organization to give them a bit of a kicking, frankly, because your code was being written twice in many cases in order to work on Netscape and Internet Explorer. And what happened down the line is other browsers popped up. You had Opera and you had KDE and Safari and whatnot. So every time somebody built a browser, they built another JavaScript engine. So you had lots of these engines. I mean, I'm going to go back to there, but you see that there's a bunch of them up here down the line as well. So each of these is completely independent from the other, apart from the others too. So that's bad, generally. Slim, I won't go too much into libraries and minifiers, but eventually the code got slimmer. Minification is renaming things so they get smaller. And libraries, jQuery is an example, but there's a bunch of them. The idea is anything that's common, you put it in the library. Anything you write again and again and again, stick it in the library, pull it down once, and then write it when you need it. But you can turn code that looks like that in JavaScript into code that looks like that in jQuery. So that's good. That's going to download much quicker. We like that. So what happened was code was slim, code was correct, but it wasn't fast. And what happened was this weird year 2008, everybody got on the fast bandwagon. TraceMonkey came in Mozilla's browser. V8 was what came in Chrome. Chrome launched that year. All of a sudden, everybody was going, yeah, we're going to run fast JavaScript. You know?
Sorry, John, are those engines or compilers?
Those are JavaScript engines built inside the browsers at the top, or the guys at the top.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. So they have hilarious names. I mean, Opera named after obscure languages. You've got Linear A, Linear B. Google do parts of a car, so you have crankshaft and V8. I don't know what Mozilla are up to, but it's monkeys. They love monkeys. But yeah. Anyway. Oh, and Safari was actually a Linux browser. They forked into JavaScript Core, became Squirrelfish, weirdest name, and then became Squirrelfish Extreme, and then it got marketed as Nitro. So it's actually keeping track of that as a nightmare. But I think that everybody's got lots and lots of them. So I was going to explain how it got fast. Right, imagine, see this diagram? We're going to ignore it, right? It got fast. If you really care, you can go here, and it's all in there, honestly. From now on, we're going to go with my other version, right? JavaScript goes in here. Magic happens. And fast code comes out there. Okay, so amazing. How do we do that? Right, so we're now fast, we're now slim, we're now correct. All the things. Right, we're on to fun stuff. I like this quote because it's kind of tongue in cheek, but it's true. Any application that can be written in JavaScript will eventually be written in JavaScript. So I was going to give you some examples now, because we've kind of built up to the point where we can start making interesting things with JavaScript, because we now know that it tops all these different things. So I'm just going to give you a few examples. Games and applications. With a bit of a browser with an engine in it, JavaScript and HTML5 and potentially WebGL, you can do games. Really fast games, actually, with WebGL. They go straight to your graphics hardware. That's nice, yeah. With the same technology, you can do, I'm sorry, you can't see that very well, but you can see, you can do data visualizations. Same technology, you're just using it in a slightly different way. But you can do these lovely interactive database stuff. With a thing called WebRTC, which is one of the new HTML5 things, you can do what Skype does, but you can write it in JavaScript. So you can, this is what Google Hangouts is effectively, it's using that. That's all done in JavaScript, but it's doing what Skype does. Facebook chat's the same sort of thing. So you can do anything, you can do pretty much anything now. It really has opened up. Because the speed is there, you can tackle much larger problems. So you can do some quite clever stuff. So it's a bit of a playground at the moment. I was going to give you some slightly more obtuse or bizarre examples, because I know you're all kind of webby people, so you've probably seen a lot of games, if you're not aware of it. But I was going to do two examples. JavaScript is everything, and everything is JavaScript, right? So let me get there. JavaScript, you can write emulators in JavaScript. So an emulator would be something that runs the code of an old computer. I guarantee if there's any computer you ever used to have, Spectrums, Atari STs, Amigas, N64s, the lot, they all have JavaScript emulators out there. There's people who've sat down and worked out how these games work, and you can go and play them on the web. And that's insane to me, you know, that's nuts. You know, you've written a language, and you're now emulating other languages. There's an entire Linux emulator. It pops up, and it's Linux, and just, you know, command lines, and there's a GUI version of the same thing. They run really slow. I'm not going to hit some of the URLs later if you want to play with them, but they are fascinating, you know. And that's a really good list at the bottom of all of them. It can also be a compiler. Now, I've explained what a compiler is now. It's the part that turns your JavaScript code into something that can run. You can write compilers for other languages in JavaScript. This is where it gets really meta. So you can have Pascal, Lua. There's a JavaScript compiler in JavaScript. You can, there is. You know? It's hilarious. But that was done as a kind of proof of concept. But the ideas are interesting. You can take another language and run it inside JavaScript, and you have something else. You know, that's useful. There must be a use case for it. You know, it's interesting. You know.
Less compilers. JavaScript.
JavaScript is money. You're making stuff with JavaScript. Why not? Let's make money. This is a Bitcoin wallet, which you can runs in your client, runs in the there, and you can it does cryptography on the client, so which is good. So it means it's not on a server, it can't get hacked because it's your stuff. That's good. You can go the other way. Everything is JavaScript. So JavaScript is actually a bit of a pain to write, frankly. I mean, it doesn't scale particularly well for a bunch of reasons. So languages popped up to make writing JavaScript easier. So you've got CoffeeScript, TypeScript, DartScript. You write in one of those languages, and then that becomes JavaScript. It just basically publishes JavaScript out. The slightly more bizarre version is this thing called LLVM. LLVM is the intermediate language for a compiler. So what that would let you do is take something that's written in C, and there's tons of C libraries. C is a very popular programming language. Everything's been written in C at some point. C has a compiler too. It writes in client, it writes LLVM, and then with this in scripting, LLVM becomes JavaScript. So you can now take something runs in C, and it becomes JavaScript on the other end. That's nuts. You know, all of a sudden you've got access to huge amounts of things. And this quote, absolutely quite controversial at the time, but I think probably pretty accurate. So I was going to give you an example of what this ridiculous situation can give you. There's an example of the Unreal 3 engine, which is a kind of gaming engine for things like Xbox or that sort of thing. You can push that out so it runs in JavaScript. So I was going to show you keep in mind the JavaScript rollover thing I showed you at the beginning, because this is where we've got to. It doesn't like Chrome. Right, so this, again, is JavaScript. This runs in your web browser. So it's going to pull down some code, hopefully if the Wi-Fi is kind to me. And again, this is a web page, same technology that was running your JavaScript rollover is now, you can't see it particularly well, but there's a lot of crazy stuff going on there. But that's insane. It really is.
Is that like a D-turn left, D-turn right sort of game?
Yeah, it's a full, you can drive this around, I'm just going to stick it on the tour for the moment. But it does benchmarks and it will do 60 frames a second quite handily, you know, which is great. That's as good as you'll get an Xbox, PlayStation, any of that. So anyway, that's cool. But that's where we've come to. I think that's what I find fascinating, is that technology's got you to a point where you can do stuff like that. Okay. This is interesting. JavaScript has data. I'm going to explain quickly the difference between the old world, which was XML. If anyone's worked with HTML, it would be very, very simple. XML. You were to describe this chap here, you give his name, and you close over the name. So that's very bloaty. That's redundant. But the name is in twice. JSON, you can say the same data in much smaller. Great. Okay. You know. Super, you know, you've saved yourselves a little bit. But what's happened is JSON's taken on a life of its own as well. So this is pure JavaScript. But there's now databases that work with JSON. So you can take JavaScript objects, as they're called, and then just stick them straight in the database. You know, it doesn't work like SQL does. It works. You just plonk them in the database, you pull them back out. You don't need parse to pull it like XML does. XML is really quite chunky to parse. So yeah, that's really good. But it turns out it's in the weirdest of places. The Nest thermostat, if you've come across it, is a fascinating thing. It's a way of controlling the temperature in your house, but it's also connected to the internet, so it knows what the weather is. It'll run off and get the weather data or whatever. A couple of guys have hacked it, and it turns out it's running JSON, so there's JSON flying in and out. So you can have a thing on the wall, you know, it's no longer in your browser anymore. The thing on the wall is chucking JavaScript across the internet to top it. So that's interesting. It's in the Mercedes S-Class, it turns out. Because there's a great list of licenses you can pull off their website. So somewhere in that car, there's JavaScript data flying around, you know, like as you're driving your car. You know, it's getting out of the browser, and it's getting everywhere now. It's becoming, because of its connectedness to the web, it's becoming the language of the Internet of Things, as they would say. So that's interesting. Node is another one. Here's a chap called Ryan Dahl, did something very interesting with JavaScript. Remember I was saying the JavaScript engine lives inside the browser. But he got rid of the browser. JavaScript engine is actually an open source project, and he put it in as a server. So where you would have a web server previously, you can now run Node, which is JavaScript running on the server side. So the same code, and it's actually the same engine, can run on the client and on the server. So that's useful, quite interesting. You deal this stuff with it. Desktop automation with Node. Think of Grunt, which is great. Lets you automate things. You can copy things from here to here. You can write scripts in JavaScript that build scripts. If you're ever working with large, it's got some fans of that. If you're a designer and think, JavaScript not interests me, it's built into Photoshop. You can actually write plugins and stuff in JavaScript and tell Photoshop to do things. It's quite cool. Yeah. The thing is, again, it's creeping out. It's left the browser now. It's kind of got big tendrils and it's all over the place. I'm going to finish up with hardware because hardware's kind of fun. You know, this is where it's really getting quite interesting. That you probably know what a Raspberry Pi is. A Raspberry Pi is a computer on a board. Very small. We have one in the office somewhere. Yeah. if you glue a bunch of things that you can't see together on the board. You can actually change the lights in your aquarium. You know, fantastic. And you follow the link and see the video. Guy did it. Because all of these technologies are here. And JavaScript sits in the middle and glues all of that stuff together. Yeah, why not? Yeah. These are popular too, the microcontrollers. So Arduino is obviously the first of the lot. But these all have ways of JavaScript talking to them. So you can control it all with JavaScript. And these let you add on sensors and all sorts of stuff, and build robots and stuff like that. Tesla particularly is interesting because it understands JavaScript on the board, which the others don't at the moment. So yeah, build robots. Of course you build robots. Hi, we're geeks, we build robots, you know. So Arduino, robot, Node, you push all that together and you get this Node.js Wi-Fi extending robot, which is, you can't really see him on the board. He's got great tracks. And he basically wanders off and drops little Wi-Fi repeaters. Why not, you know? I like that. Make your own drones. There's a GitHub repository for controlling AR drones. Yeah. How much fun is that? And again, you know, we're not in the browser anymore. Same thing that was doing your JavaScript rollovers is flying this crazy thing. Yeah. So anyway, I'll wrap up. What we learned. JavaScript, the language, JavaScript, the engine. JavaScript talks the native web languages, and that's really useful. It can read and write both of those things. It also, you can turn any language you like into JavaScript, and JavaScript will pretty much run other languages too in emulation. And Node, JSON, which is JavaScript as data, is beginning to appear out on the web. It's becoming, beyond the web, devices and those sort of things, and in the Nest and in the Mercedes cars and stuff like that. So it's becoming useful, it's becoming a way of these devices talking to each other. Obviously you can run JavaScript in the browser, but you can also run it on the server and on these devices running on these Node servers. So yeah, there you go. Thank you for my time. Oh, it was interesting. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you.
Any questions? I'm kind of almost scared to say.
I'm going to copy them.
I have one.
Yeah.
When you talked about it being written in 10 days,
yeah.
How different was that product to what we see now? Would we recognize it?
What you had then was, it's still JavaScript because it got specced quite quickly afterwards and Microsoft picked up on it. But where they were going, they had a bit of course change at the end, and that's why it was crunched. It was, you know, they had ideas of what they wanted to do, and in the end, they kind of rushed towards this other thing, and that's why it was a bit of a push to get it there. There's a interesting, if you're interested in that stuff, there is a good list you can go to and get the whole story of it.
But in that first version, the most of the basics were there.
Yeah, the language is there, and the compiler. You know, he prototyped the compiler. It wasn't kind of finished, but you know, the gist of it was there, and all the main design decisions were in there. At that time. So yeah, it is like you said, nothing short of a miracle. It's actually useful. But what I think was the most interesting thing out of that was it was built to be changed because of that time constraint, and that has been its most useful feature. You know, it's. People just turn it into anything, you know. It becomes this weird, sticky language, and sits between and joins disparate things together. So if you can join, if you wanted to, you know, that's learn JavaScript because you can stitch things together and just have a bit of fun. You can make your own aquariums if you wanted to. Anything else? Yeah.
Could you expand a little bit on the database side, the NoSQL?
Yeah,
you got any sort of examples of
I can give you
or?
Some links to them. Yeah, I mean the way it works. Well, NoSQL, they're kind of sprung up around Node and around the JSON format. The JSON is if you write and you create an object. An object is kind of anything you want to store. You don't have to turn it into a particular format like XML. You'd have to write out XML. From JavaScript and then have it interpreted at the other end. What JSON does is that's just an object you pass around in JavaScript. JavaScript is very, it likes playing pass the ball. You know, you make an object up, you chuck it onto the next guy. It has this idea of chaining things, so you just pass the objects down. But that's a native object. But what you do with that is you just go now, stick it in the database, and the database is ready to accept it without having to turn it into something else, and you get it back like that too. You can also run queries like, because it's not like SQL. SQL's like tables, you know, and you run the thing across the tables. This is all about structured data sitting inside these databases, and you can
as
run
object.
Yeah, so you can run queries on that and across all of those objects. So you can. It's a different way of thinking about it, but it's fast as well. It's really quite good.
Where are they all stored then? They stored in the browser as well.
Well, the databases are server side things. Yeah, but you can run them from Node and stuff like that. You can definitely run them.
Yeah, local storage is
But if you think about it, if you wanted to store a piece of data in JavaScript, that's the obvious way to do it. Just stick it off in one of these databases and pull it back as was, you just pickle it, send it back again.
Right.
But yeah, it's very good.
Yeah, because you quite often take an object and turn it into
a
format which you can then put a normal
database.
Think
how much time you spend parsing XML or something like that.
And then put it back and turn it back into an object again.
And you're not doing any of that either. It doesn't get transformed in the journey. So there's also this less can go wrong. If you're writing a parser, a lot of the time, if you screw it up, then things go bang, But because there's no parsing involved, you just say, here's the object, now the object back. Great.
Or worse still, it doesn't go bang and you get some substitution
where you've heard the minimum and
the maximum field.
And it's also quite slow. If you parse a huge XML object, it'll take a while to go through. It'll still take a while to send JSON object too, but.
What's your, I suppose, broad question about your favourite use of JavaScript, as in sort of just for frills and giggles?
Mucking about.
Yeah.
I did love that WebGL demo. The castle is just because it blew my mind that that was actually even conceivable. Somebody sat down and what? I can get this thing from C and I can throw it into this. It's just, who's sitting working that stuff out? That's an entirely different way.
Why would they be doing it?
Well, it was a research project to begin with. But I have soft spot for the flying drones. I want one of them. it's good. And they're actually quite cheap. They're like £200 or £300.
The one with the dropping Wi-Fi repeaters.
Yeah.
That's quite mental. And what I was going to say is with the Raspberry Pi stuff, the competitions they hold in schools is quite inspiring stuff.
There's a really interesting site called NodeBots, if you go there, and that's for writing robots that are powered by JavaScript and Node and that kind of thing. And they basically go up against each other with tasks and things that they get to do. There's a London NodeBox club you can go to. Yeah, it looks interesting. The thing I'm thinking is we're just at the beginning of this. It's sort of bleeding out into the real world. And then give it 5 or 10 years and it will just be everywhere. It's become this sort of language of...
It's not the easiest language to learn, though, is it?
No, Python might be easier, or Scratch or something,
But when that happens, will everybody know that? Will it have the name JavaScript, or will it be something that's more user friendly for kind of everybody?
Plumbing, you don't notice it. That's the thing. Unless you're a plumber, I notice it because I'm kind of working with it, but I think it's invisible. And one of the things that I wanted to get across in this is let people realize that all of that stuff is going on and where it's come from and what it's turned into. But I think it's like plumbing, you don't see it.
can you just explain again the bit where you had the thermometer, was that?
Oh, the Nest.
Yeah, the Nest.
Thermometer,
yeah.
So it's probably worth going to their site, but the idea behind the Nest is it's a learning thermostat. So if you have a sort of AC controlled in your house, it learns learns when you like this room cold, this room hot. It checks the weather and it sort of measures everything out. I think it was made by one of the guys on the original iPod team, actually. So that's why it's got that really stylish design. It's really nice, and there's an app, of course. This is kind of a different topic, actually. But with phone, you now have an interface. You don't have to. The problem with things like smartwatches and any of these things in the past is they're really fiddly because if you wanted to try and control them, you had some kind of voodoo to make it work. But the way that these things work now is that all of the app has the interface for it. So if you wanted to configure something, you go to your app, and it's a much nicer experience to control. So that's what the Nest is doing. It's got a lovely sort of simple, stylish front end to it, but there's a lot of clever stuff going on in the app. And of course, it's connected to the internet, so it's got all the data about weather and that sort of thing as well. So all this stuff is sort of joining up now. But when it joins up seamlessly, you don't notice it. Yeah.
So if your internet connection goes down, it's just a lump on the wall.
Yeah, I've said that. I didn't cover it, but there's a really interesting video codec written entirely in JavaScript. It's like H.264 or something like that. But the idea is that you can remotely control some of the 3D Studio Max is like really big chunky program. So instead of running that on your computer, it takes in your keyboard or whatever your user interface is, sends that over the wire, runs the whole thing in the cloud on some machine, and sends you back a video of what's going on. A lot of gaming things work this way as well. So all of a sudden, that's just gone away. What you can actually run in your machine, if you run video, you can run anything on the machine because that.
So you're using a client.
Yeah, you are. But the problem with that is, I reckon, is if your internet tanks, then you've got nothing. You know, you've just got a dead video client. Yeah, but it's really fast and it does really work. There's some good demos of it, of basically running Max on one machine and running this in Firefox on another, and you can't tell the difference. That's not cool. But again, you know, somebody said we need to write a video codec. We'll write it in JavaScript. So then there's no plugins, there's no licensing issues, and nothing. You know, just done. So. It's really versatile. I mean, you can turn it into anything you want. Cool, we're done? All right, thank you.